Hello, and welcome to this IMA special webinar hosted by IMA Switzerland Chapter and CMA Nanjing Elite Club in China. The theme of today's joint webinar is Global Insights, Navigating Change, and will be presented in both languages, English and Chinese.
Thank you, Margaret. Hello and welcome. Tianchu da Chia Chung Chu Kuai Le. Together with Chu Chu, I'm pleased to be your co-moderator for today's joint webinar. First, we want to thank IMA and everyone involved who makes this kind of event possible. And I'm happy to introduce Chu Chu. Chu is a strategic financial consultant, and he's currently operating his own consulting firm in Nanjing. The company provides services to improve management accounting practices in small and medium enterprises and startups in China. Chu has been an IMA member since 2014, founded the CMA Nanjing Elite Club 3 years ago, and this July became an IMA Global Board Director. I personally had the opportunity to meet Chu the first time at one of IMA's annual conferences. Chu, welcome.
Thank you, Marco. Hello, everyone. This is Chu from Nanjing Elite Club. It is a pleasure to moderate this international webinar with Marco today. 大家好，我是南京 CMA 精英俱乐部的祝清，非常开心能和 Marco 一起主持今天的这个 webinar. Marco 呢是 IMA 欧洲董事会的董事，同时也是 IMA 瑞士分会的成员。瑞士分会和南京精英俱乐部在今年正式成为了兄弟俱乐部，这也是我们第一次共同举办活动。Marco。
Thank you, Jude. Now we would like to introduce our speaker presenters for today. First, we are pleased to have Thorsten Feix with us. Thorsten is professor at the University of Applied Sciences in Augsburg, Germany. His research interest is focused on M&A, corporate finance, and innovation strategies. He also teaches at other schools, including an M&A course at Harvard University. Thorsten worked for more than 15 years as an in-house consultant for well-known companies such as Daimler, Bosch, and Siemens, and realized more than 70 global transactions. In addition, he is a board member of the Bundesverband M&A in Germany and recently started his M&A and strategy advisory boutique. Thorsten, welcome.
Hello, Marco. Hello, Jude. It's a privilege to be today with you and to have a very intense and I'm pretty sure interesting discussion with you and you all together on M&A, which is my heart, my belief, which I love, and which I did on the science side as well on the practical side. So many thanks for the invitation.
Thank you, Dr. Thorsten.
Yeah.
Sorry. The second presenter is Marshall Ma. Marshall is a co-founder of Easy Finance, Anyue Zixun, one of the leading company of management consulting in China, and a platinum partner of IMA China. 中国的小伙伴们应该都知道安岳咨询是中国最早也是最顶尖的管理会计咨询的和培训的公司。下面有请马总和大家打个招呼。来，马总有请。大家好，我是马手。
是安岳咨询的创始合伙人，我们公司很早就在中国提供管理会计的培训和咨询服务，和 IMA 的合作呢，也有这个十几年的这个历史，非常高兴今天有机会和大家呢一起分享这样的一个话题，同时呢我们也有这个来自瑞士的精英管理会计的专家。
Very good. Okay, we have three learning objectives for today. With this first in-kind webinar, we would like to engage accountants and financial professionals in Switzerland, China, and globally to share their knowledge and experience on how to thrive in a rapidly evolving business environment. Therefore, the speakers will both share their insights for about half an hour, and after we go into the Q&A session for around 15 minutes. So feel free to use the Q&A window to submit your questions and comments. First, we will hear from Thorsten Feix on M&A processes with an end-to-end perspective in an international context. Second, Marsha Ma presents the crucial links between management accounting and strategy in alignment with the top management. Jude, would you like to introduce the learning objectives in Chinese as well?
Sure, Marco. 本次 webinar 我们有三个目标，首先是促进管理会计的国际交流。 包括在中国、在瑞士以及全球。第二呢，是由Dr. Feix 来分享一下全球环境下的兼并收购，这个过程大约是半个小时。然后第三部分呢，是由马总分享管理会计在中国的实践和战略的这个联系，这个也是大约半个小时。最后呢，大家有15分钟的提问时间。 在分享的过程中间也会有提问的环节，所以请大家踊跃的参与。Okay.
Good. As a first input, let's look at how the finance function is helping to navigate change during and after a period of crisis. Of course, the coronavirus outbreak being the most recent example. McKinsey published a relevant article on the topic, which basically highlights three stages for the finance organization. The first one being resolve and resilience. Finance leaders had to address the immediate crisis by focusing on liquidity. A lot of operations temporarily shut down and supply chains got disrupted. Working in the automotive industry myself, I had a first-hand view on these developments. So the top priority for finance is ensuring liquidity, optimizing cash reserves and implementing a cash culture, even as the duration of the impact remains unclear. Also, potential scenarios should be developed, maybe two or three, to forecast sales and cash movements, even though underlying assumptions might change very quickly. Considering working capital might not be sufficient, CFOs can look at divestments, joint ventures, or relief on debt covenants. At this stage, proactive internal and external communication is very important. This includes employees, board of directors, and investors. The second stage is return. It is characterized by operational improvements to support productivity. On the revenue side, the development of new products and services can be promoted. And on the cost side, actions can be taken to reduce operating costs while maintaining flexibility. A good example would be to introduce zero-based budgeting approach for certain expense categories. It is also necessary to analyze the balance sheets. This means reviewing goodwill impairment, refinancing debt, reducing inventory, looking at accounts payable and accounts receivable terms. Finance teams have to accelerate their forecasting work, providing frequently updated information and monitor KPIs, also for the coming months. The final stage would be reimagine and reform. Now the top management has to find ways to move forward and strategically plan for investments and portfolio shifts. This includes reallocating resources for future growth with a strong M&A and CapEx process. Also adopting a transformation mindset when setting targets, creating budgets, challenging growth assumptions, and expenses. For example, thinking about transformational plans that would increase revenues or costs not by 5 to 10%, but by 30 to 40%. Changing markets and decreasing valuations can create opportunities for M&A. Therefore, a systematic M&A approach may help your company outperform others. And with more remote work, the use of digitization, automated closings, and real-time forecasts become very important. So for us, what does this all mean for our profession? As management accountants, we should be able to navigate within a business framework to monitor conditions and provide higher value support for decisions and growth opportunities. Our speakers today will address some of these elements in more detail. With that, let's move to our first poll question. Jude?
好的, 在请出第一位嘉宾之前呢，我们先请大家思考一个问题：您认为您所在的企业处于哪一个阶段 ？A 是处于这个初创阶段，以存活为最要紧的目标，还是 B？ 业务已经进行了一段时间的这个稳定，业务已经稳定了，还是 C？ 那么有长期的这个计划，要采取大胆的投资战略等等规划。您有30秒钟来回答。Please begin to respond to the polling question, and you will have about 30 seconds to do so.好的，我们看到已经有超过半数的attendees 做了回答，所以说我们来看一下答案，看起来好像是一个非常平均的答案，有四分之一来自于这个初创企业，啊，刚刚这个进行了这个可能初期的这么一个商业规划，那么现在以存活为目标，那么剩下来的超过三分之一的都是以这个短期业务稳定和长期做战略规划为主的，那么这个可能也在我们的预料之中。那我们下面就请 Marco 有请出我们第一位这个 presenter。Marco.
Yes, thank you, Jude. Thank you. Very interesting to see at which stage the companies of our participants currently are. Now I would like to give the word to Thorsten.And his presentation on applying an end-to-end M&A process design for navigating change. Thorsten, please.
So first of all, once more, Marco and Jude, many thanks for the invitation. And I think the presentation, or I hope the presentation, is nicely linked what we saw right now by the pool question. So if we reflect the long-term view,In the 2010s, what we saw was a push in innovation in multiple industries. And what you had in your pool question that shows the third answer, and a lot of participants answered still now, despite the fact we are in the midst of the COVID crisis, or hope to come out of that, innovation plays still a massive role. But as we learned already at the beginning of the 20s, the 20s will look quite significantly different. So it will not be just innovation, it's also to the need to build the resilient business designs. And that we saw in the McKinsey paper, also in the new book we released, we call it, it's Resilient Innovation, what we discussed in our Harvard course together, Marco. We call it also M&A for Resilient Business Model Innovation. And that we saw also in your pool question. So that was quite interesting. So the participants who said,the short-term view is very important, was roughly the same size as those who answered innovation or bold moves in the long-term view is interesting. And therefore, I called to this presentation the end-to-end M&A process design. We hope that's a model which supports us to build robust but also innovative business models by merger acquisitions.And that's dedicated for corporate strategy in the 20s. So first of all, I brought with me an overview. And then the presentation, you can say it's in two parts. First of all, the first part does focus to explain today's or try to understand today's merger acquisition markets globally. And secondly, how we should maneuver in these M&A markets by consulting tools and scientific tools. So back to the origin of merger access, the second part of transaction management dominates the headlines in the newspapers, in the Financial Times, Wall Street Journal, in the Chinese newspapers or German newspapers. So typically M&A does focus on what kind of values are realized, what have been the prices announced by the acquiree. But if you come to that subject, that might be too narrow. So for sure, the pricing, the synergies realized is important. But beforehand, we have to define what is the true reason why we go for a merger acquisition. So we call that embedded M&A strategy. So we have to answer why do we acquire the target company? And we have to assess, is merger acquisition the best way forward, or are there alternative models? So Marco mentioned that already. We have alternatives. We have the possibility to go for joint ventures. In my last company, we did it multiple times, for example, in China with Chinese partners. Or we can incubate a business model. We can use accelerators. We can use strategic alliances. Or last but not least, we can build a company by our own. Another issue which we have to solve, that's the third stage, we have to take care about the integration management. So it's not enough that we acquire a company. So if you have a corporate acquiree, we have to take care about how to integrate companies. Then a fourth pillar is synergy management. And we think that will become very, very important as well in the 20s. Only an M&A deal does only make sense financially wise if the net present value of the synergies are higher than the premium paid in the acquisition. And we saw yesterday night, for example, in the biochemical sector, multi-billion acquisition by Gilead, so one of the global players. They paid for the acquisition targets in immune oncology, 21 billion, so quite a sizable amount. And the premium paid in this acquisition was 104%, so quite a massive premium. So having said that, the synergies must be there that you can justify for your shareholders that this acquisition does make sense. And the last part, and that's quite interesting, that's impacted by digitalization. So in the end, merger acquisition is a project, so it has to be handled as a project. And digitalization, what we see, offers us huge improvement potentials. So that's roughly the idea about our model. But first, let us take a few on the latest moves on the global M&A market before we go into a deep dive of this model. So here you see the development in the last couple of years, starting from 2010 to 2020, how the M&A market developed. So you see after the global financial crisis, we had the lows. And then we saw a spike of the global M&A markets in the end of the 10s, so roughly speaking from 2015 to 2019. So in academia, there's right now discussion or even a consensus that we call this one the seventh M&A merger wave. That does mean we saw in the end of the 10s a lot of activity in merger acquisitions. So roughly the volume, it depends on the source you take. But the consensus roughly is that we had in the last couple of years, each year, volume of $4 trillion. And we can reverse calculate that does mean purely by transactions, around about 6 to 7% of the global market capitalization changes hands. So very, very vibrant market. For sure, we saw then the drop-off this year with the COVID crisis. But what is interesting, despite we saw here the drop-off, a couple of companies did a lot of acquisition. That caught our interest. So our research interest was, what are the true drivers of the seventh merger waves from a market perspective? And that is interesting. If we go into the details, it is it was linked in the sense to new business design. So we saw a lot of we need a short discussion, what do we assign? These are technology-driven business designs. They have a pattern, very often built around platforms. Very often they are easy to scale due to the fact that we have platforms. And I brought a couple of examples with me. So one example would be the ride-hailing market. If we take companies like Uber and Lyft in the US, both had an IPO last year, or in China, Didi, I guess, is still the market, the front runner. These are typical business designs which are built on a platform and in a purely digital basis. Another example would be Airbnb as a local accommodation provider. So Airbnb does not own any real estate, does not own any hotels. So it, in brackets, just provides the connectivity for those who are searching for a room in a certain city and those who provide. Another example, very interesting ones, are the large communication providers in China. You're much more familiar with WeChat or Skype, or nowadays what we used here in the German market for the university, or also for Harvard University for schooling purpose, the Zoom platform. So also that one, typically these are not heavy balance sheet businesses. These are light balance sheet businesses built around a platform, bringing together two parties or multiple parties. A further example is on the retailing side. So with Amazon or Alibaba on your end, we have two very powerful houses. And also they do not own the assets, so they're your digital powerhouses on the retailing space. And both of them gained, despite the COVID crisis, gained massive ground. So with the lockdowns, they gained also massive market shares. If you go to the media side, Facebook, YouTube, if we go, we can do the same fintechs with Alipay. We have also in Europe, they might be not so well known. N26 is a term champion. It's a purely digital bank. One of my loved one fintechs is TransferWise. They do the global money transfer. Also from our university, we have a focus on fintech and insurtech industry. Also that is fascinating. And also those companies gained massive ground during the crisis also this year. Then, no surprise, Netflix is a must-have. For Harvard, we used a massive case study on the streaming revolution. That's fascinating. And also, that's a nice link, by the way, to merger acquisition. So Disney acquired for a quite heavy amount of $56 billion US dollars. Then the Rupert Murdoch 21st Century franchise. So we see directly the impact of those business models. So if you're challenged by those business models as an incumbent, you have to think how to renew your business model. And even a powerful house like Disney, they had a need to acquire other companies. And last but not least, the tech champions like Apple and Google. So these are the business models. And what is interesting, despite we had then in springtime and summertime, the crisis or the impacts of COVID-19, these companies, in the midst of the crisis, they still went for merger acquisition. And to start a bit with the strategic rationale, what is interesting, so Apple acquired NextVR. So NextVR is a virtual reality company. And we will see that tomorrow with the announcement of Apple with the new iPhone 12 and the iWatch. So what will be the next step of Apple with this strategic acquisition? So for sure, they will go a bit more in virtual reality. They have multiple possibilities. The estimate is from analysts and researchers that they will move more massively in the gaming space. Or what Amazon a couple of weeks announced, they acquired Souks. The Souks will offer them the opportunity to enter into autonomous drive. So here the expectation is from the value chain perspective, with the last miles, that autonomous drive might give them the next level for the business. If you take Amazon Web Services, so they're 100% affiliate, then in cloud services. Microsoft did multiple acquisitions also for artificial intelligence and cloud services. The same was true for Facebook. Just to mention maybe Reliance, that was the market entrance in India. Also Google did a couple of acquisitions, very focused ones, interesting-wise. Also for office efficiency, which will be after the COVID crisis a huge issue, with the separation between homework and in-office work. And as a last example, Intel, they did a multiple acquisition. We had also, for a Harvard case study, the acquisition from Intel of Mobileye for the camera system of autonomous drive. And Movit is an add-on Israeli acquisition. So having said that, our understanding of the market, of the M&A market, the seventh merger wave was driven and is still driven by merger acquisitions. And I just made the notes what happened the last 7 to 10 days on the M&A market. So it's still once more quite vibrant, despite COVID is not solved. So you might have read that NVIDIA acquired Arm Holdings. That's a high-tech chip company. And NVIDIA is in that game, so that does make sense from SoftBank for around about $40 billion. Then General Motors entered into agreement with Nikola, that's autonomous drive for truck, so compete also pitch on the Tesla business model. We have the discussion between US and China on the TikTok model. Oracle seems to be on the front runner. Or yesterday announced on Wall Street, the mentioned acquisition of Gilead in the biotech side of Immunomedics for 21%. So it seems that technology is very important. So the next question is, how does it look like on a specific company level? And we did a bit of research on platform companies. And these are the acquisitions purely on Amazon side. And what you see that's interesting, they do not run the acquisition just very close to their core business. So they have breakouts. So these indicates to breakouts where Amazon from a corporate strategy would like to go. The biggest one was in 27 Whole Foods, the acquisition that gave them the footprint beside the online business, also on the bricks and mortar retail business. Or what I mentioned before, the acquisition of Xoox, that's not very sizable in comparison to the market capitalization of Amazon, of more than $1 trillion. But it shows that Amazon works of an end-to-end model in their supply chain for the last mile. And that might give them the technology lever to execute. So having said that, now the next question is, are those acquisitions successful? And there the question is, how do we define successful acquisition? So for us, acquisition is successful if the net present value of the synergies is higher than premium paid. And typically that's measured in assessments with the relative total shareholder return. So it's simply measured at announcement, how does the stock price respond? So does the stock price after announcement outperform or underperform your peer group? That's quite interesting. We had a lot of discussion on the strategic rationale, but still the performance of merger acquisition has not increased. So it's a balanced mix. So roughly 50% are successful, 50% are not successful. And there's more or less a proof of a lot of statistics. So this one was assessment by Boston Consulting Group. You can also take assessments of KPMG, Pricewaterhouse, McKinsey, or academic research papers. So all of them show that roughly 50 to 60% of the deals fail. And therefore, what Marco and Jude and I thought it would be interesting, the next pooling question, where we would like to ask you, what is your experience? So why do merger acquisition still fail? And Marco, we said, it's also allowed to have multiple answers. So if you think it's not just one reason, you can make a cross also on multiple reasons. Would you like to comment that shortly, Marco?
Yes, thank you, Thorsten. Yeah, you should see now the next polling question. And as mentioned, we would like to know what you think, why so many M&A deals still fail. And the options are, if possible, you can choose multiple options. Is it due to strategic rationale, valuation, due diligence, or integration issues? Again, please begin responding to the question now, and you will have around 30 seconds to do so. Okay, let's see the results.
Very interesting. Yeah. So, that's 40%, so that's by a couple of percentage points the most said missing strategic rationale. To be honest, it was exactly also our estimate that the strategic rationale very often get lost in a transaction. So maybe at the beginning we discuss about that, but during the transaction it's somehow lost, and that's a huge risk, because as a corporate acquirer, also always to answer what is the true rationale. Then the second most reason, integration hurdles. That's more or less perfect. That Marco was exactly what we discussed in the Harvard lectures, right? So the pattern roundabout. But as well, still due diligence and valuation is not done. So front runners, missing strategic rationale, second integration, and a third then valuation due diligence. And that's interesting. So that was also our assessment. It's also a bit in line what we saw in the mentioned study of Boston Consulting. So you see that in the upper hand, we have more strategic reasons. So they ask about in a wide setting of M&A, companies who execute M&As, and you see your response is quite a massive amount, say either we have a missing strategic fit or we took the wrong candidate. So if you put that together, 40 to 50% said we have a strategic, a floppy strategy in the background. But also a lot of companies, as you also mentioned, is they are not perfect in the integration side. And last not least, market timing. So it's roughly in line. Your answers have been roughly in line by the assessment of Boston. And that led us exactly into how do we have to build M&A design which improves the success rate. Once more reflecting, we have $4 trillion per year is invested in merger acquisition. And round about half is unwisely spent, so that's $2 trillion. So it's a very inefficient way to execute merger acquisition. And that was the research question or the consulting question we put in place around about 2.5-3 years ago, and which gained massively traction. And I guess that was also the reason why we have been invited even by Harvard to introduce our approach. The starting point was we discussed from a scientific point of view. So what are the needs of a robust M&A design? We thought four drivers might be of essence: speed, because as you know, in merger acquisition we have a limited time frame. It must be very efficient because we have multiple parties involved. We have not our employees as acquiree. We have also consultants in there, maybe investment bankers, maybe lawyers. And we have to find agreement with the sellers. So multiple parties, and therefore it must be a very efficient process. It must be a high quality process. We know that from due diligence and valuation. And last but not least, it must be proven that it's robust and resilient. So we took those four criteria, and we built around those four criteria M&A process model. So as said, no surprise, we started with transaction management. But we said that's not enough. So we understand on the transaction management, the hardcore, the valuation, the quantitative part, the valuation and the due diligence and the negotiation. That's not enough. So we need a strategy and as addition, the integration management. So the transaction management has to be framed by the strategic rationale. That was exactly your pool question one, that the strategic rationale is missing. And pool question four, that the integration is missing. And that would be an end-to-end process. And we said we have to underline that with the synergy management. So also synergy management must go from the beginning till the end. So it must be at the beginning, the justification. And in the end, we have to realize the synergies. If it's just a PowerPoint chart, it's paper money, but we would like to have real money. So therefore it's our fourth process. And last not least, the fifth one is the execution. So the tools, we work on massive digital tools development and the governance criteria in the project management. So that's total model. And I brought with me just two examples out of time reasons. So we will discuss the potentials of an embedded M&A strategy from a portfolio view. And secondly, I hope that's interesting for you. We call that front loading from integration management into transaction management and embedded M&A strategy. And I will explain. So we think by the front loading of integration questions, like the business design, how we integrate, and by the culture design, that we can massively improve the success rates of merger acquisitions. So having said that, just two tools. One example from the strategy side, we call that's business model innovation matrix. At the beginning, we said merger acquisition is one strategic tool, but it's just one out of a portfolio of different tools. And what we created is a matrix, so from left to right. So on the horizontal side, we pinpointed the time frame. And on the vertical side, we have how close is the business to the acquirer's business? So is it very close to the core business, or is it more distant? So if we take merger acquisition, we can, the charming point of merger acquisition, we can execute it quite fast. So typically it's a time frame between 3, maximum 6 months for a multi-billion international transaction. And we can use merger acquisition for the core business, but as well for more distance market, what we saw before. But another alternative might be if we think M&A might be not suitable, we can use also divestments. It does mean if we own businesses which have not anymore a close link to the core business, the flip side would be unlocking value by divestments. More for innovative business, maybe more for businesses which are more distant to the core. Business incubation and venturing offer us potential. We can go for alliances and partnerships. Typically, these are instruments which are used for more distant touch points, not for the core business. We can use as an alternative joint ventures. Or last not least, we can build the business design in-house. So that's a theoretical holistic model which fits nicely in our approach. And it just brought with me, how does it look like? So don't get overcrowded by it, but we did it for multiple industries, and that's from a especially from a European US perspective, the automotive industry, just selectively. And I will just pinpoint, because I live in Munich, that's where BMW has its headquarters. So if you take a company like BMW, they execute at the same point of time from corporate strategy multiple tools. And from a Chinese perspective, it's interesting. So BMW intensified ties with Great Wall Motors in the joint venture where they produce the electric Mini, the small car. And they intensified the times with the ties with Brilliance. On the same time, they created with Daimler and Audi acquisition vehicle to buy out from Nokia, the telecom champion, here, that's for autonomous drive, a backbone technology, which is and the startup garage. These are incubation and venturing models, but for sure they do also a lot of in-house developments. So having said that, so this is just one example where we work with boards, and from an academic point of view, we think that gives us a nice overview. How does a merger acquisition fit into the corporate strategy? And if you would have more time, we link that quite massively with the strategic rationale. The second model which we use or develop is that's based on the business canvas theory, is that already from the beginning, we front load questions, how should the business model look like if we integrate the target company? And we developed a new process. So we start, we kick off this question, which is typically an integration question, already in the strategy phase. So we run a diagnostics of the business model of the acquiree. We supplement that with diagnostics of the target company. And based out of that knowledge, we try to understand already how could a blueprint of the joint business design look like already in the strategy phase. And this has two advantages. On the one side, in transaction management, we can cross-check if this is reasonable and robust, the joint business design in the due diligence. And secondly, from day onwards, we can integrate and execute this one. So these are just two out of a portfolio of tools and processes which we developed from the academic side and apply on the consulting side to improve M&A success. So due to the fact that we have just half an hour, so you will find much more. So that's the model. Oh, it's just flip-sided. Anyway, if you have interest, that's the brand new book, which we for the first time applied for the Harvard lectures this year, a couple of months ago, where I met Marco. And that's available on Amazon.com, for example. And as an alternative, if you have interest, you can send me just the email. We will kick off in 2021 a hybrid global benchmark. That's from my consulting business, where with very, very interesting companies. So that's a mix between online and offline in-person meetings. So each quarter we will meet in certain hubs, and where we bring the academic side and consulting side into the corporate world. So that's roughly, Marco and Jude, what I prepared for today, and I think we are exactly in the time frame. So many thanks that I had the privilege to present in a nutshell the ideas we developed in the process.
Thank you very much, Thorsten. Very interesting for your insights on M&A and presenting also some use cases from diverse industries. You also clearly highlighted the strategic challenges for M&A processes, so that's pretty good. Before we move to our second presentation, I will hand over to Jude for our next polling question.
Thank you, Mr. Thorsten. 好的，在开始第二个分享之前呢，我们还是来一个polling question。以下哪一条不是管理会计师面临的挑战？这个是选择一个否定项。A 呢是管理会计和战略的脱节。第二个呢是 B 是这个组织架构的这个过时 ，C 呢是财务人员缺乏业务知识和商业的敏感度，第四个呢 D 是这个财务应该是财务人员缺乏这个对于这个财务报告法规的一个理解。有30秒钟来选择。Please begin to respond to the polling question, and you will have about 30 minutes to do so. 好的，非常感谢大家的参与。我们看到，最多的这个选项选放在了这个outdated organizational structure。那这个选项，其实请大家注意，我们这边选的是否定项，就是选择你认为哪个不是他们的这个挑战。所以本来我们在设计的时候没有想到会是这个选择，我们在设计的时候想到的是这个对于财务法规的这么一个误解。那么这块可能不是我们现在管理会计师最重要的这么一个挑战，但是呢，看到大家的这个分享，我们觉得对于我们来说也非常有启发。那么下面就有请马总来给大家开始他的精彩的分享。马总有请。
好的，大家好。IMA咨询呢，在中国做培训和咨询呢已经有16年的这个历史了。在这个过程当中呢，我们做过很多的这个咨询项目。我们回顾一下，在十年前的时候，管理会计这个话题呢是什么样的一个热度，可能很多这个 CMA 的会员呢都会知道。其实十年前的时候呢，理解管理会计，在企业里推行管理会计，实际上是一个凤毛麟角的事情。那只有呢非常大规模的企业或者是跨国公司才会呢在企业里面呢推行管理会计。绝大多数的中国企业呢并不了解管理会计。那个时候呢中国还是处于一个商业机会非常的好，发展非常快的阶段。所以企业呢只要是抓住商业机会，只要去做就能够挣钱。这时候呢毛利率非常的高，以至于呢精细化的管理以及这个或者说管理本身对企业来说呢都是一个负担啊，因为挣钱的机会实在是太多了。但是到了这个随着这个时间的推移啊，企业不断在发展。在五年前，大约是2015年的时候，中国呢就开始了一个全国甚至说政府主导的在推行管理会计的这样的一个活动啊，我们可以把它叫做一个运动吧。整个中国呢管理会计的话题非常的热。那为什么会是这样呢？因为企业呢把发展的红利，把商业机会的这个红利呢用的差不多了，就需要精细化的管理了。毛利率也没有那么高，竞争非常的激烈，而且也充分。同时呢中国这个快速发展的新兴市场的这些这个应该说带来的这样的一个比较高利润的一个状态呢，随着中国劳动力成本的提升以及呢各方面的这个情况的变化，有了根本性的这个转变。所以企业呢越来越重视，政府也越来越重视。大量的我们管理会计的应该说从财务会计到管理会计的转型，有很多这个企业呢在推行。同时呢很多我们财务从业人员也意识到了这样的一个危机，也开始呢转型学习管理会计从事管理会计的工作。但是到现在为止，我们虽然说这个管理会计在中国已经被很好的推行了，我们从我们的调查当中呢也能得出这样一个结论，大约有79%的企业呢都在推行管理会计。可实际上呢我们还是遇到了很多的这个问题。比如说管理会计我们学了很多，我们也呢是这个 CMA 的会员或者说其他这个协会的会员，都在这个积极的学习和推行。但是企业呢同样呢企业还是有他们的这个在推行的过程当中呢也会有一些疑问。首先呢这个管理会计的人员非常的难找。其次呢发现呢并不符合企业这个要求。反过来呢从管理会计这个角度来说呢，在企业里面呢没有很好的应用环境。我们学了很多东西，也呢可以有很多的工具去用，但在企业里呢发现其实用不上。我们在2018年呢也做过这样一个调查，在企业里面管理会计推行最主要的障碍是什么呢？这障碍呢应该是这样的几个。第一个呢就是高层领导呢缺乏支持。高层领导一般在中国现在这样的企业里，高层的领导呢往往是不懂管理会计的。他们懂什么呢？他们可能懂战略，他们可能懂销售，可能懂这个抓住商业机会。但是管理会计呢对中国的企业来说实在是一个新的名词，实在太新了。以至于呢以前养成的管理方式管理习惯很难短时间改变，而且呢也不知道如何去改变。这是企业高层面临的一个现状。那另外一个困难就是什么呢？企业的信息系统啊 其实是不支持我们管理会计的推行。管理会计的推行呢，需要什么？需要信息。如果没有信息的话，管理会计的推行呢，就是空中楼阁。但是我们以往的信息系统，首先呢是不发达，其次呢，信息系统在实施的时候呢，没有管理会计思想的正确的指导，以至于呢，信息系统为了实施而实施，在实施的过程当中，数据的颗粒度、数据的采集方式、归集方式，以及呢这个总结和生成报告的方式，都不是我们管理会计的想要的这样的一个方式。对企业来说呢，很有可能这些数据从这个产生的那一天起，它就是用不上了。那这是应该说信息系统呢，对管理会计也是一个重要的一个制约。再有一个非常重要的制约点，就是企业的流程和这个流程的设计，它也是过时的。那过去是业务导向的，业务导向呢，那这个流程呢，可能只是方便业务的运转，并没有想到管理要求的这个提升。那管理要求这时候如果提出来的话呢，发现呢，实际上这些流程呢是过时的，这一点呢也是一个重要的一个制约因素。这些呢，我们都可以去做，都可以克服，但是我们在企业里面呢，普遍的发现的问题就是，千亿级的企业，我们把这个企业呢可以分为千亿级、百亿级、几十亿级，以及呢更小规模的这个企业，我们发现呢千亿级的企业各个环境呢都是相对来说比较好一点，管理会计的推行呢相对会比较容易，但是几百亿级的企业就不一样了，这个环境呢推行管理会计呢就相当相当的困难。那在这种情况下呢，我们看到绝大多数的管理会计从业人员，因为千亿级的企业毕竟是少嘛，绝大多数的管理会计人员就要面临着这个企业的推行的管理会计环境不具备这样的情况下呢，还要做这个工作。在这样的一个环境里，如何去做这个工作呢？经过这么多年我们的这个咨询呢，发现呢，其实困难还是相当大的。除了上述这些困难以外，我们本身怎么找到这个突破口，怎么去找到这个切入点，是非常的困难的。然后呢，通过我们咨询项目，我们其实做了一些努力和尝试，也有了一定的突破，发现呢，还是有窍门可以去找到这个切入点的。那切入点是什么呢？其实就是战略。但恰恰呢，我们管理会计人员在这个推行管理会计或者是学习过程当中，很有可能认为战略呢太空太虚，跟我们关系不大，建立不起来战略和我们之间的联系。而我们想一想呢，在企业里面，企业的高层如果要引起高层的重视的话，恰恰呢我们必须讨论战略，因为对于一个企业来讲，它的战略是非常非常的重要的。那么我们又如何去切入战略管理的这个过程呢？我觉得这里面呢就要看一下我们企业的战略到底做得好还是不好。绝大多数的企业，就像我刚才讲的，我们把企业分类以后会发现呢，千亿级的企业战略做得还是不错的。我是说中国企业这个现状啊。到了百亿级的企业，其实战略呢这个过程就有相当大的提升的空间。而这一点呢就是我们管理会计可以发挥作用的一个地方。好，我们现在看一下啊。我们到了一个企业，这个曾经呢在山东，我有一个挖掘机的这样的一个企业，我们到这个企业呢去做这个战略的，不是做，应该说做管理会计的一个咨询。但是在这个过程当中呢，这个企业的这个领导呢就问我们一个问题，我们公司呢有单独的一个战略部门，但是呢我们发现他每年做的战略最后呢都没有实现，问我呢这是什么原因。那么这是什么原因呢？我也很好奇，我说你们为什么会这个一直都不能实现的这样的一个战略，然后你们每年都在做呢？我们就仔细做了一下调研，在调研的过程当中我们发现这个企业有单独的战略部门，但是这个战略呢它做的过程呢它仅仅是在做战略，它没有做其他的事情。一个战略做出来是要实现的，但企业仅仅把战略做出来了而不能保证它的实现，那这个战略过程呢其实就是不完整的。那么我们看看他做了哪些事情，没做哪些事情。我用这样的一张图呢来表达一下战略呢，要把它保证实现的话应该有哪些过程。我们看呢，左上角这是战略目标。在一个企业 做战略肯定要做战略的目标了，对不对？但战略目标有了，是不是就能够实现呢？我们去咨询的这家企业恰恰呢就是在做战略的目标啊，不断的每年都把这个战略目标做得很漂亮。那另外的三点呢他们并没有去做，而另外三点呢非常的重要。第二个象限看就是什么呢？组织能力。第三个象限呢是资源分配。第四个象限呢是绩效管理。只有这些呢形成一个闭环，我们的战略呢才能够保证它的实现。那我们一个一个来展开讲一下战略目标制定的过程有哪些问题，我们管理会计呢如何呢去在这个战略目标制定过程当中呢发挥作用。战略目标的制定呢它应该是从上到下统一的，是一致的。但中国的企业呢有一个问题，有很多这个不管是国有企业还是民营企业，它的战略目标我们发现呢会是领导的一篇讲话，会是一个对于经营目标的一个含糊的一个叙述，而下级呢和各个层级呢都对这个讲话进行学习，然后呢去确定自己的这个局部的这样的一个目标。但实际上我们是有更好的方法解决这个问题的，而管理会计呢就提供了这方面的工具。我们很多企业呢做战略目标在顶层的时候是清晰的，往下分解的时候呢没有经过从上到下和从下到上的这样的一个循环的一个过程。而现在我在屏幕上列出的这些管理工具呢没有得到很好的一个应用，甚至说没有应用，或者还有一些企业呢在最高层面进行了应用，在下面呢就缺乏这样的一个讨论或者是战略分解的一个过程。制定战略目标的过程是非常的简单，非常的时间的非常的短，比如说半个月一个月就把这个战略目标制定好了。这个呢我在一些大的跨国公司工作的时候这是不可思议的一个事情，因为在大的跨国公司制定战略的目标过程可能要持续半年，而这些管理工具呢都会得到充分的一个应用。现在呢我们在中国有很多的民营企业国有企业对这一点呢认识的不深刻，以至于呢我们管理会计这些工具在学习的时候是学的，实际工作当中呢缺乏这样的应用。我希望呢如果我们管理会计的从业人员在这个企业里面要切入战略点的话呢要从这些点去出发，比如说我们要做 SWOT 分析，我们要做 7S， 我们要做这个 Five Force 这些分析，把企业的战略目标呢把它变成一个可理解的。可理解是什么意思？领导理解，领导说这一句话或者是领导讲一篇话的时候它不是一个战略目标，它只是它的一个想法。怎么才能把想法变成整个公司的想法？那这些工具呢就可以发挥重要的作用了。我们学了这些工具，那一个一个分析下来呢我们才能够理解领导的讲话，同时呢也要修正领导的指出的这样的一个方向是不是正确的。因为在分析的过程当中就会发现呢有很多事情呢你想象和真正的经过定性定量的分析以后它的成果它的结果呢是完全不一样的。只有从上到下从下到上的去运用这些工具和方法去把我们的战略目标变成每一个层级都能够理解的东西以后，这个应该说战略目标的制定过程呢才能够算是完成，才能够呢充分的被整个组织理解，而不是说呢这个领导理解了然后下面就去执行。很多战略目标不能够很好的被实现就发生在战略目标制定过程当中本身就是有问题的。当然这里讲的呢是战略目标制定的这个过程。这个过程制定了以后实际上呢并没有完成。我们接下来的一个目标呢接下来的一个阶段就是要盘点组织的能力。盘点组织能力是什么意思呢？就是要用战略目标和我组织所具拥有的这样的一个实现目标的能力之间呢进行匹配。如果我的目标和我组织能力是匹配的，那这个目标是合理的。如果不匹配呢，那这个目标要么修正，要么呢我去完善我的组织能力。那么如何完善组织能力，其实管理会计呢也提供了很多的工具和方法。这些工具方法如何应用呢？我简单的归纳呢，你这个组织啊能力呢要实现肯定有三个渠道。 三个渠道是什么呢？假如说我们现有的组织能力和战略目标的这个实现的之间有一定差距的话，有三种方法可以弥补，无非是第一个呢，就是说这个培训现有的团队，现有的人能力不行，那我如何呢让他拥有这样的一个能力去实现这个目标，这是其中的一个渠道。第二个渠道就是说我现有的团队培养起来呢，可能周期会很长，或者会很慢，或者会这些人呢不适合这样的一个培养，即便是培训了，他也不可能达成这样的一个目标，那我就是需要呢去招募一个新的团队，或者是新的一波人去实现这个目标。还有一点呢，也是可以采纳的，就是把我的这个战略目标，我去把它外包给另外的一个团队，让用外部的公司外部的资源呢去实现这么一个目标。无论怎么样，这个目标呢，我们的战略目标和我们的组织能力呢要进行匹配。比如说我们这张图的左边，这个 PPT 的左边看到，我们要实现这个目标，我们组织能力有几块是缺失的，我们无法用现在的这个组织去实现这个目标。那么我们呢就用刚才我们讲过的这三种方法呢去补足，让这个能力呢看起来呢它是和这个目标匹配的啊，当然不只是看起来，它一定是能够胜任这样的一个目标的。在这种情况下呢，才能保证这个组织我们制定的目标呢它是能够被实现的。在组织能力盘点了以后呢，我们组织能力盘点很多工具就可以用上了，这就是我们这个战略呢和管理会计结合的另外一点。那接下来呢，我们就要看组织能力有了之后，我们要进行资源的一个盘点。资源的盘点那不用说，我们首先就是全面预算这样的一个体系。这个体系呢就是我们管理会计很重要的这么一个环节。这件事情在中国呢有很多企业在做，但是呢做着做着呢事情就发生了变化。那有这样的几个变化。第一个呢，这个预算呢它脱离我们的目标。它变成了一个什么呢？变成了一个费用预算，变成了一个例行公事的这个控制成本的一个方式。预算呢，它最主要的目标其实不是控制成本，不是控制费用，而是说呢，规划公司的目标。而这个目标的实现呢，完全靠全面预算这个体系呢，给这个目标分配资源。如果分配的资源不适当，这个目标是不可能实现的，或者呢，分配的过于充分了，以至于呢我们浪费了很多的资源，那这个公司的目标呢也就是或者是被低估了，或者说呢目标是有缺失的，实际上组织呢资源呢可以支持更大的一个目标。这些呢我们管理会计有太多的工具了，比如说全面预算管理体系，以及呢我们投资收益分析等等等等这些工具那在这个层面上呢是可以得到很好的一个应用的。而很多企业里面呢，我们往往呢就是可能在从事预算的工作，可能在进行投资分析，但是呢仅仅就这个事项进行这个工作，而没有把它和我们的战略目标联系起来，这时候很难引起公司层面的重视和公司各个部门以及领导给到资源的这样的一个支持。这也是需要呢我们从事管理会计的工作人员呢一起要努力改善的一个地方。所以要把它放到战略的角度去考虑，而不是说呢我就是负责帮忙来控制成本的。这是资源。最后一点呢也是非常重要的，就是我们要有合适的绩效机制来保证战略目标的实现。开始提到的这个企业，就山东的这家挖掘机的公司，他做这个事情呢除了目标定得非常漂亮以外，其他的三个都没做。那最重要保障这个目标能够实现的，实际上呢就是我们的绩效机制。而绩效机制呢，如果在中国我们做过这样的一个调查啊，绝大多数企业里还在用这个 KPI 做这个，大概70%的企业都是在做 KPI 的这样的一个考核。而这个 KPI 的考核呢，它是不是从战略目标出来的，这个是一个很大的一个疑问。因为 KPI绝大多数的企业呢并没有从战略目标出发，也没有从全面预算分解出这个 KPI 来，而是说根据以往的经验，然后呢确定 KPI， 根据这个确定的 KPI 又进行着考核，它和战略目标呢是完全脱离的。当你制定一个战略目标，你如果没有一个这个奖惩的说法的时候，实际这个目标和你具体的工作执行它就是完全没有关系的。 那比如说那个山东这个挖掘机的企业，当时我们在说你有这样的绩效目标吗？其实是没有。他说那你这个年终考核的时候，如果没实现了怎么样，没实现怎么样呢？它实际上呢，这还是一个平均数，一个大锅饭的这样的一个状况。这种状况呢，绝不是少数。那我在另外一个这个企业里也看到了这样的情况，它的规模已经几百个亿了，它最后年终的时候还要搞平衡，还要看一下谁的这个苦劳多一点，而不是看呢谁的功劳大一点。如果一个企业还在这样去做的话，那我们这个战略目标呢，实际上实现不实现都没有关系，这个企业还是在靠惯性在运转，还是靠原有的这个资源在运转。至于这个 KPI 的考核，用什么方法去替代它？现在越来越多的呢，比如说 EVA 啊，比如说这个360啊等等，这些管理会计的工具呢，都会得到很好的一个应用。我们在中国越来越多的看到企业在用什么样一个方式在进行考核呢？就是阿米巴。这个阿米巴呢，它不仅仅是一个考核方式，它同时是一个目标分解的一个方式，以及资源分配的方式和这个能力呢进行这个提升的方式，所以它是相当综合的。在企业在中国呢，目前来讲呢，有很多很多的企业都在学这个阿米巴，学阿米巴，这恰恰呢就是我们管理会计啊应用的一个另外的一个非常综合的这样的一个案例。企业呢，你可以学阿米巴，也可以学华为，也可以学海尔，可以学很多很多比如说还有一些企业呢是用这个中国的传统的这个儒家这个思想在进行这个哲学方面的这个建设，文化方面的建设，这些都是没问题的，都是可以的。但是落地靠什么呢？落地都要靠管理会计，都要靠这个化小核算单元，然后呢进行及时的量化的显化的这个绩效考核。说绩效考核，有些企业可能不这么说，但是呢实际就是这么回事。如何激励人，如何组织人，如何激发人的这个潜能，如何公平的对待每一个人的这个价值创造和贡献，这些呢是企业呢非常重要的这个组成部分。如果不能够从这个绩效方面解决这些问题的话呢，我们企业的战略目标呢，它是没有办法呢是从制定那一天起就确保它实现的。只能是说呢，我们这个走到哪里算到哪里。刚才我讲的这些，可能大家觉得呢，这个企业如果是这样的话，那这个企业应该是一个不好的企业。可能恰恰相反，在中国呢，很多企业呢，都是这个样子的。我们看到的，只要你深入去观察的话，这个企业呢，都有这样的这个问题。因为中国有企业不过才三四十年的时间，企业发展呢还在一个初级阶段。管理的很好的企业呢，一般来讲都是规模非常大的，比如说华为，比如说海尔，比如说美的这样的企业。但是呢，只要是规模这个小一点的企业，或者说呢，这个没有经过深刻的管理变革的企业，它的管理环境呢，确实是相对来说呢是比较弱的。而恰恰这就是给我们管理会计的机会，给我们管理会计从业人员一个非常好、非常大的一个机会。那我们呢，要脱离我们这个传统的思维，传统的比如说以前可能我们是从事财务会计的，那这些思维呢必须要突破，我们必须到战略层面，必须到资源层面，必须到这个组织能力层面，以及呢组织保障这个层面去思考问题。我们所掌握的这些管理会计的工具呢，才能在企业里面呢得到很好的应用，才能够引起管理层的重视，才能够引起业务部门的重视。我们在企业里面其实是有两个老板，一个是呢最高领导，另外一个就是业务部门的这个主管。我们必须让他们能够理解我们在说什么，在做什么，让他们能够信服我们，我们才能够呢施展我们的才华，把我们所学的东西在企业里面发挥作用，创造价值。好的，我的分享就先到这里，大家有问题呢我们可以讨论，谢谢大家。
Thank you very much, Marshall, for your input. So let's welcome our presenters to the Q&A and see what our attendees are asking. Maybe I can start with Thorsten. I have a question for you.
Sure, always welcome.
Good. So one participant asks, aren't all these takeovers by tech companies proof that even executives of those companies think their stock is overvalued, assuming many of the takeovers are paid with stock over cash.
Yeah, but it's a very, very interesting question. So we overjumped that. We have different from the M&A technical wording, we call it the means of payments. So we have different means of payments. We can, in former times, typically acquisitions have been paid in cash, but what we see more and more indeed, that's true, especially in tech acquisition, that acquisition are paid partially or fully in shares. So also these success rates are sometimes measured. Is it more efficient to pay in cash or in with stocks? And also, for example, if we take the latest acquisitions, very often we see in the mean time a mix. So first of all, the question is very reasonable and it's up to date. What does make sense, if and that depends on the perspective, if you are the acquirer or you are the target. So for example, if the acquirer would use shares for the acquisition, it puts you as the acquirer maybe a bit more on the safe side if we are on highly valued markets as we are right now on the technology shares. Because if you have a decrease in your market cap, also in principle, it's one-to-one linked to what you paid with your shares. If you put the cash on the table, for sure, you have to take care as the acquirer that you really realize the synergies. So if you would pay, let's say, in a tech acquisition, quite a sizable premium, let's say 50% of the market capitalization of the target co, you have to be sure that the synergies which you realize, the net present value of those in the long term are also 50%. So having said that, from the acquirer's point of view, it absolutely does make sense to limit your risk exposure to pay, especially in tech acquisitions, partially with your own shares. Coming to the side of the target company, so if the market is really on the high side, if that is a fair assessment, there might be a bit of a risk exposure. So partially you get paid in cash, cash is cash, so that's one by one. But you are dependent how the shares of the acquirer develop then in the future because you're partially paid. So if you're not automatically, let's say after day two or three, you sell off the shares of the acquirer, you're dependent on the share price development of the acquirer. And you cannot simply say it's good or it's bad. It depends, because if the share price of the acquirer would increase, that could be the case, for example, because the acquirer could really realize massively synergies by acquiring your business. Then for sure it does make sense, or it would be an upside that you participate on the synergies. But if you have the sensitivity that maybe you got a very good price for the acquisition and the acquirer overpaid, maybe it's not a good choice to take the shares of the acquirer. So having said that, super interesting question, very up to date, but the answer depends on the perspective as well.
Thank you very much, synergy is the magic word in M&A, right? So.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And that was also nicely linked to the research we did. So on the valuation side, we have excellent textbooks by Koller, that was released yesterday, the new one, the 7th edition, by Dem and Darren from Stern University in New York. I was surprised by running the research for my new book on the synergy management side, and therefore we have a separate chapter on that. There is not too much research, but on the other side, it determines if an acquisition does make sense or not from a financial point of view. That's a bit surprising even on the academic side.
Okay, very interesting. Jude, do you have a question for Marshall?
Yes. We have a question in Chinese from Vincent. 马总，我想请教您一个问题：您觉得中国的管理会计水平和世界水平相比，咱们主要欠缺在什么方面呢？
中国的管理会计应用水平呢，肯定是刚刚起步的，这是肯定的。 因为我们的环境还不太具备，但是呢，在中国呢，因为管理环境呢相对来说比较复杂一点，就是比这个欧美的管理环境要复杂，所以管理会计的应用呢，它的前景呢是应该说非常的好的，就是有太多的场景呢我们可以发挥作用。因为中国不只是管理会计的水平有差距，中国企业的整体的管理水平呢相对来说呢，它首先呢就是起步晚，它水平呢不高，另外呢中国管理环境的复杂度主要体现在两个方面。第一个呢就是社会信用体系呢它是严重不足的，第二点呢就是人口素质差异比较大。我们看日本、看美国、看欧洲，劳动力的素质呢相对来说呢比较这个聚集度比较高一点，就是差距不是特别大。但在中国呢，这个企业里面的从业人员，就是这个员工啊，他的文化水平和各方面的素质差异是特别大，有特别好的，也有特别差的。那在这样的一个环境下呢，企业要做的管理工作就要比这个欧美的企业要多得多，复杂度要高很多。那企业管理越复杂，需要管的事情就越多，甚至很多呢，社会信用体系、法律体系在美国、在欧洲都能解决的问题，在中国呢都需要企业来管理。在这种情况下呢，企业的管理就需要呢更多的应该说用管理会计的工具啊、方法啊、思路啊，去把这个企业呢管得更细、管得更好。那么刚才我也讲了，就是说整体的差距其实不只是管理会计方面，这个环境的差距是比较大的，人口素质的差距是比较大的。只不过呢它给我们管理会计提供了更大的这个发挥的空间，同时是个坏消息也是一个好消息。好，谢谢。
谢谢马总。Marco?
Thanks, Jude. I have another one for Thorsten, quite interesting. So how would you expect competition authorities to behave now during this time?I mean, will they be more lenient towards too big to fail acquisitions organizations? I mean, in Switzerland, it just came out the rumors of a possible merger between global banks, Swiss banks, Credit Suisse and UBS. Do you have a view on that?
Yes, so the regulatory authorities, also over that we jumped, they are extremely important for the overall merger acquisition. And there are multiple reasons for that. Very well known is the regional bit of disputes between US, China and Europe, acceptance of merger acquisitions. So that might be limiting a bit merger acquisitions, that all the regions get more home-based, so to speak. The second super interesting question about too big to fail. So as a region in academia, we discuss still the outcome of the global financial crisis 2007-2008. And there was a huge discussion about too big to fail about the banks. So exactly what you said right now in Switzerland, the first rumors of a maybe merger between UBS and Credit Suisse. Yes. So that would create a true powerhouse, and they are already powerhouses. So coming from that point, regulatory authorities have been, let me be frank, quite weak to jump into that and to say simply that's too market dominant. So there's a likelihood of or a risk to fail. But I guess due to the lessons learned we had in the 2007-2008 crisis, step by step, what we see, for example, in Europe by Mrs. Vestager and also the influence of Mrs. von der Leyen in the discussion, that the competitive authorities and the oversight get strengthened. But I think that's not from today till tomorrow that we get a very very strong regulatory body, but I would say it's under progress. And from my point of view, UBS and Credit Suisse are already very powerful houses, not just in Switzerland, in Europe and globally. So that would be, as I heard the rumors, I would be super interested what would be the true answer of the regulatory authorities. So coming back to the question, step by step, what we expect is a strengthening, regional and big to fail questions. But for sure you have our document is like to build a good, and that's the trade-off what the regulatory authorities have to handle.
Yes, and if we look at the market, the initial market reaction today, it was quite positive for both shares, UBS and Credit Suisse.
If we would discuss it in detail, it's interesting. After the global financial crisis, as we had a focus in our research at the university on fintechs and intertechs and also the banking regulation, we said if we compare the German banks with the Swiss banks are much better in the performance because they very early restructured the business after the global financial crisis. And that was interesting. So from my perception, the UBS strategy and Credit Suisse strategy, they went into different ways. They also restructured in a different ways, equity trading, debt trading, underwriting businesses. And if they went into different directions, and from a strategic point of view, if you put together the business units, it could make sense. So, but that depends really. So we are back to the discussion about synergies.
Yes, so let's see how it turns out. Jude, another question.
Oh, thank you. We have audience concerning the connections between risk management and management accountants. So I'm going to ask Marshall this question. 马总，我们在这个有很多这个听众在询问这个风险管理和管理会计师之间的管理会计之间的关系。那这个话题呢，在今年尤其是疫情当下，可能更加有意义。那么您是怎么看这个风险在管理会计中间的这个作用和角色的？
风险管理，我们过去呢，风险管理呢，我还是讲中国的企业啊，因为这几年呢，中国的企业发生很大的变化，对风险的管理的要求也不一样了。前些年的风险管理往往集中在哪里呢？就是对于流程的管理，对于这个事项风险的这个控制上，就是哪些事情呢会是有风险的，哪些事情是不能做的，要遵循什么样的流程就可以控制什么样的一个风险。这个呢相对来说还是比较初级的这样的一个管理的一个方式。那管理会计对于风险呢，我们是有工具的，而且管理会计对于风险呢，我们是要量化的。那这量化呢应该是管理会计做所有事情的一个很重要的一个特点，就是所有的风险我给你量化出来。风险其实不是说非黑即白的一个东西，说这件事做了我就有风险了，那件事没做我就没有风险了，或者说这件事我做了这个风险就可以防范住了，实际上不是这样的。任何风险都是有概率的，任何风险呢一方面有概率，另一方面呢它还有危害度的这样的一个衡量。你如果不能够量化，不能够显化出来呢，那你控制风险的成本会很高。如果你是风险防范的这个意识很强的话，那这个企业风险防范的这个成本会很高的。但是呢有限的资源投到什么地方去，我们就是需要呢对风险进行量化。量化比如说它的概率啊，比如说它产生的危害啊，这些呢都要进行这个量化以后呢再进行风险防范的这样的一个投入，这个对于成本的一个控制。另外一点呢就是说对于一些这个企业的这个本来呢可能我们以往呢不在我们这个应该说管理的范围之内的这些风险，相对来说长期的这些风险，那比如说这个机会成本对企业来讲呢，以往呢我们可能很难衡量它，但是现在呢随着管理会计的这个数据越来越容易获取，以及呢我们模型的建立呢越来越具备这方面的人才，模型建立越来越充分，我们会发现呢对于企业的机会成本也是可以量化的，而量化之后一旦量化了，实际上呢它也是一个机会又是一个风险。那你失去了这个机会其实对企业来说呢就是一个风险。但在我们没有管理会计没有这些量化的模型之前呢，实际上这些东西是无法衡量的。这就是我们管理会计的对于风险管控来说呢，它又把风险管控的这个应该说是层次又推高了若干个层次，让我们风险管控呢为企业可以发挥更大的价值，创造更多的这个应该说这个控制风险点呢，创造更多的这个利润点呢，发挥这样的作用吧。谢谢。
Thank you, Marshall. Marco, I think we have one more question for each presenter.
Okay, good. Let's do that. Maybe a final question to Thorsten. I mean, as we have a cross-cultural audience today, there are culture differences between Asian countries and the West, and also different management styles. Why does corporate culture have such a significant impact on M&A?
Yeah, also a super interesting question. So in the end, it's about people, right? So it's about merger acquisition. We speak a lot about what we did beforehand, synergy, strategy, money. But in the end, to execute merger acquisition and to make an acquisition, especially from the acquiree side, successful, that's about people, about integration. And here comes culture massively into play. So I fully agree. Culture is easily set, but harder to be defined. So I'm also with you. It's very under-delivered phenomenon. So what we did also in our research and for the new book, we tried to get a more detailed understanding of culture. And we said culture has three pillars. The one is what you mentioned, the regional culture perspective, also the diversity. There exists a bit of bunch of literature assessment. It started with Feix data, which is well known. We studied from an IBM perspective 20 years ago, the differences between European cultures, US cultures, Asian cultures. So we have a couple of insights here, but we think it's not only about regional differences, it's also about business differences. Just one example, if incumbent company buys a startup, there might be also from the organizational side differences and from the cultural side. So the typical business culture of a startup might be different to a typical business culture of a huge organization. And thirdly, what we saw that the management behavior, so the top management has an impact. So we created a culture model, we call it culture design, which it takes certain criteria and where we measure what are the differences, the gaps between the acquiree and the target in the regional part, which are the differences from the cultural architecture of the two companies, and thirdly, what are the differences in the top management behaviors. And that we call diagnostics, and if we have there a fair picture, then we can think about what is the best way to integrate companies. But coming back to the original question, that absolutely addresses by 100% the culture issue, which is really of essence in merger acquisitions.
Yes, thank you very much, Thorsten. Chu, to your final question.
Okay. We have a question in Chinese. 非常好的一个问题，就是如何看待在中国 国有企业对于管理会计不重视的情况，有些国企甚至没有设立专门的部门。作为会计人员，我们如何去推动国有企业重视管理会计？马总，您怎么看？国有企业呢，首先，现在呢，我在我看起来也是越来越重视管理会计了。这一点呢，有政府推动的作用，也有这个市场竞争的这个需要。有一些企业呢，也在进行这个管理。 市场化的改革，比如说混改啊，像我们最近有一些客户呢，比如说南方航空，这是这个非常大的国企了，就是亚洲第一、世界第三的航空公司，它内部呢也在推行管理会计，所以很多事情呢都是在发生变化的。一个国有企业，如果现在呢财政部 在要求国有企业在推行管理会计，如果有一些企业呢动作比较慢的话，不代表着它呢未来的一段时间之内呢不会启动这样的一个项目。所以在这个企业当中呢，作为管理会计的从业人员，我们像我刚才讲的内容，就是说呢，我们要上升到战略层面，上升到组织能力层面呢，去讨论这些问题，而不要让企业的高层管理者认为我们是在做会计的工作。 这个呢，这个翻译啊，我觉得是很要命的。就是管理会计呢，把它翻译成这个管理后边带个会计，就很容易让这个不懂管理会计的人误会，以为呢我们是另外的一个会计的一个证书，或者是会计工作当中的一部分。
确实有这样的情况的，就是在企业当中这个对这个东西的认识不足，所以我们积极的推动内外环境呢肯定在发生变化。五年之前的时候，我们很难想象管理会计能像现在这个样子呢去这个这么普及这么热门。当然最后还有一个办法，就是说呢你可能要努力的寻找啊，有没有这个管理会计，假如说我们是一个管理会计的从业人员的话，那我们周边有没有这个做管理会计做得比较好的，对这个管理会计人才比较需求这样的雇主，那我们呢要保持这样的一个随时寻找的这样的一个心态，可能呢总有一天你会碰到一个好的机会。实在是世界这个中国的管理会计人员的缺乏程度啊，大家是难以想象的。我们经常帮助企业呢招募管理会计人员，一个人我们找半年是很经常的事情。如果说是需求呢，不是特别资深的，找半年都很正常。如果是资深的话呢，你可能要花上一年两年的时间才具备这样的能力。那我们很多时候都劝企业，你算了，你不要招了，我们先帮你做项目，同时你从你的现有的团队当中培养好了，等你培养好了，可能你那个人还没有招到呢。实际上现在呢就是机会非常的多，人才呢非常的缺乏，那大家不妨呢多方努力，共同推进管理会计，也为我们这个社会呢创造一些价值。谢谢。
谢谢马总，看样子也是说到了马总的痛点。So that's the final question for today.
Thank you, Jude. So we want to thank our presenters for sharing their knowledge and expertise with us. We appreciate very much that you made time for IMA and our audience today.
感谢各位嘉宾的精彩分享，也感谢各位观众的参与。
谢谢。
Thank you.
It was truly a pleasure to co-moderate this bilingual webinar today. Before we go, I would like to say a few words about the IMA Switzerland chapter. Our chapter has around 250 plus members, which makes us the third largest IMA chapter in Europe. I would say that we are quite a diverse group of professional and student members, and also very international. If you'd like to learn more, feel free to visit our chapter website and follow our activities on LinkedIn.
我也简单介绍一下南京俱乐部。CMA 南京精英俱乐部是一个充满活力和创新性的平台。职业会员均在南京地区有影响力的企业担任资深的财务岗位，比如博士，比如爱立信、国药、江苏舜天等。同时呢，南京也是一个高校资源非常丰富的城市。俱乐部也汇集了许多优秀的高校教授，比如南京大学、南师大、南京农业大学、南京审计大学等等。所以说也欢迎大家通过LinkedIn 或者是这个微信来关注我们的活动。Thank you for your supporting.
So thank you everyone for your participation in today's event, your commitment to IMA and your professional development through this webinar. We are looking forward to our next webinar.